Hello, I'm Gail Eichenthal. I'm the Director of Arts Programming at KUSC-FM, Service of the University of Southern California, and it is my great delight today to introduce to you the distinguished violinist, recording artist, longtime 50-year veteran of the USC Thornton School of Music faculty, pioneering studio musician, concert artist, and all-around amazing person, Eudice Shapiro.
That sounds like so much.
It's you. It's all you. It's a delight to be with you again and to look back at your extraordinary and I would have to say unique career. What isn't that well known when you read Eudice Shapiro's bio is that her students occupy major positions in orchestras throughout the country, also in music schools throughout the country. Many members of the Los Angeles Philharmonic here in LA have your name in their resume as teacher, and that's just such an extraordinary record. Let's go back to your own beginnings as a musician. I read once that you started studying violin to get your dad's attention.
True enough, because he was a violin teacher in Buffalo, New York, where I was born. And at four, I resented that the students were taking up too much time, and they were all small, young. He loved working with little people, and decided that's what I was going to do too, and I was going to take lessons from him just as the other people were.
So it wasn't as if you were drawn to music itself or the violin itself, it was more to get your father's attention.
Well, both, because he always said that he played into my crib when I was very, very tiny. And I guess he wanted me to be a musician, a violinist, because it was really the love of his life.
And he himself was a professional violinist.
Oh yes, he played in the Buffalo Symphony and did a lot of teaching and playing.
So when you took lessons from him, is it true that you actually dressed up as if you were just another student and came to the door?
That is, I went out the back door of the house, came in the front door, ringing the bell, just as the other students were doing.
And how did he treat you? Did he take you seriously as a student?
Oh my, yes. Mm. Oh, indeed. Indeed. And evidently I did show some talent because I was playing already at 5, 6.
So there is something true to it being in the genes, that, as they say?
I think so. I think so. I think it's an inherited thing, definitely.
Music talent is inherited, mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it seems.
My mother was a pianist, always played for me when I was a child. And music was in both our families.
When did you first start seriously performing yourself?
At 10, I won a contest. I won a contest with the Scherzo Tarantella Wieniawski. And that's kind of strange because my instrument, my violin today, was once owned by Wieniawski. And it was the first, all these things sort of go together, you know.
That's a hard piece, as I recall.
Well, it's a show-off piece.
So you showed off. And then were you actually performing in town? Did you travel as a young age?
Not too much traveling, but mm-hmm. quite a lot of playing for different clubs, mostly women's clubs, you know. And to have a child play for them was, in that day, and a girl child was interesting for them.
It doesn't sound, though, that you had the sort of typical prodigy growing up with, you know, not being treated like a normal child. It sounds like you were both an amazing violinist and a fairly normal family.
I think I had a rather normal life. Yeah. Of course, I could get out of drying the dishes if I went to practice, but that was something else.
Does it bother you when you see young kids today sort of paraded around at a very
young
age?
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Because I think they need to nurture it, and they need to live with it, you know, as long as possible because it's a mental thing too. You know, one has to really think about what one is doing, and it's very difficult for a youngster to absorb all of that. Takes years,
really. I guess you have to have something to say as
an
artist.
Right, right. Yeah. And you know, I'm still learning. That's one of the beauties of teaching the violin. You learn every day from every student because each one perhaps has another problem or a fulfillment, and you learn from that too.
What kind of teacher was your father?
He was marvelous with children. And it's interesting, my son, I took him to Buffalo after we lived here in California. I took him there for a couple of weeks, you know, to visit the family. And my dad took him under his wing with a little violin. And in 2 weeks, he had him playing all of the Suzuki things that the children are doing today. And I have a picture of him, and the stance is just beautiful.
Do you think you were influenced as a teacher by your father, by his methods or the way that he related to kids?
Oh, very much, very much. Because I remember things that he told me as a child, and that was a long time ago.
Things about how to play the violin?
What to do with it, yes. In those days, of course, they didn't mean anything because I was imitating. But when I had a mind of my own and I could think about what I was doing, I realized how impressive he really was as a teacher.
And were there brothers and sisters as well?
Yes, I have a brother and I had a sister, yes. Both very musical.
Is that right? Yeah.
My brother says he sort of blew his way through college.
Horn, flute?
Everything. Anything really? You could blow.
Tell us about the decision to go to Curtis Institute to study.
Well, that was my father's idea because being in the Buffalo Symphony, he was treated to all kinds and all people who were soloists with the orchestra. And he listened to all the violinists. I think he had in his mind, where was I going after I left him? And he heard Ephraim Zimbalist play, who was the eminent violinist of the day. He was one of the Leopold Auer young students, you know, with Yasha Heifetz and with Milstein and with all of the greats of the last generation. And he heard Zimbalist, and Zimbalist was then teaching at Curtis, and that's where he wanted me to go. So we went off, and I did an audition and got in.
And how old were you when you started at Curtis?
I was just touching 17. I had gone through high school.
And I gather that there weren't a lot of serious female violin students in your class at Curtis at that time.
No, as a matter of fact, in my class, I was the female. And that was very nice. No, we had, and I had, I made lifetime friends with all of these people. It was a marvelous school. It was a small school. We only had 9 people in the class, in Zimbalist class. Mm-hmm. And we were just all friends, and we played chamber music together. We played, of course, in the orchestra there. And at that time, we had Fritz Reiner, who was the conductor of our orchestra, so that was a great learning kind of thing, too.
What was he like in that
role? Very strict.
Role?
Very strict. With the tiniest beat you can imagine, you could hardly see that finger move, you know? But we learned. We learned orchestral playing, we learned chamber music, and we learned solo playing.
Well, you must have gotten a lot of attention as the only girl in the class.
Oh, I did. Yeah. I did. I said I was the queen bee in those days.
Was there any sort of, aside from getting the male attention, did you feel at all discriminated against? Were you taken as seriously as the male students?
Not at school, but in later years when I began to solo and I began to play concerts, there was a discrimination, I'm afraid. Mostly the people who had soloists or recitals were women's clubs, music clubs, and that kind of thing. And I think they wanted a man on the platform. So it was a little bit difficult in that it was difficult to get a manager because they were really not interested in women violinists in that day. And that was actually, it was through winning the Federation of Music Clubs award that I began to go out, because then the women had to hire a woman because I had just won this club contest. And of course, they had concerts all through the United States, and that's where I started really playing solo works.
You know, even for me, growing up in the 1950s and 60s, to see an orchestra today like the LA Philharmonic or the LA Chamber Orchestra, at least half women, is still sort of fills me with pride and good cheer, because even in my childhood, there were precious few women, especially in the major European orchestras. True. And that was discrimination, was it not?
Of course it was. But it's interesting, too, because I have so many more girls coming out of high school wanting to major in violin than it used to be.
Well, that there's really been a revolutionary change,
yes,
almost,
yes,
isn't there?
Yes. And I'm so proud to be part of that, you know. I got this wonderful letter from a girl in New York City who had been just hired to play one of the Broadway shows, thanking me because I had made a career and I was concertmaster at RKO and Paramount Studios. And she said, you know, you've sort of broken the way so that we get to play Broadway shows now.
Well, that's a pretty big deal. Talk about meeting your husband, and before we get to the studio career.
Uh-huh. Well, Victor was a cello student at Curtis also. And I always had my little coterie of young gentleman friends. And we lived in the west side of Philadelphia, so we had to take the streetcar to Curtis, which was in the middle of the city. And we used to travel together because there were two other boys who lived in that vicinity, mm-hmm. and Victor was one of them. And as a matter of fact, his family boarded a young student in my class, Felix Slatkin, who was very prominent here in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm. The father of Leonard Slatkin, right?
I beg your pardon?
The father of Leonard Slatkin.
That's right, yeah. That's right, yes. And so Victor and Felix and I used to travel together back and forth from home. I was staying with a family in West Philadelphia at that time.
Wasn't Felix Slatkin one of your swains?
Yes. We saw each other every day. Yeah.
So you were in great demand.
I was in great demand, and we had great fun. They were wonderful, wonderful days. And it was an interesting kind of thing because there was no friction and no jealousy there. We were just friends, and we were all doing the same thing and having a good time doing it.
But you and Victor somehow
we
decided to make beautiful music together.
Yes. We decided. I decided I wanted a cellist for a husband.
Okay. And how is it that you decided to come out to California?
Well, part of it was that Victor was at that time the cellist of the Coolidge Quartet, the foundation which was in at the Library of Congress in Washington. Mm-hmm. And they did a lot of summer playing on the West Coast. As a matter of fact, the first time we came out, the Coolidge Quartet did a Beethoven cycle at USC. Mm-hmm. Everything seems to sort of blend and come together. And we had a lot of friends living here who were doing studio work. In other words, the background music for the movies. And they all kept saying, why don't you move out here? You'd want to live in New York. And I didn't like living in New York. To me, it was a rather unfriendly city, although I wasn't there that much. Mm-hmm. I did a lot of traveling in those days. But one summer, we just decided that maybe we should put some roots down and have a family and maybe Southern California was the place to be. So we decided to come out here, and luckily we both began to work here after a year of living here.
And you were both working in the studios
at
that time?
Yes. And also there was Werner Jansen was the name then. There was a chamber orchestra, and I was concertmaster of that. And then there was the Los Angeles Chamber Orchestra, and I was concertmaster of that. So we had lots of music going, and it was a good place for me, and behind a microphone in the studios, they didn't know whether I was a woman or a man, and it was easier for me to be busy here.
There had been no female concertmaster of a studio orchestra before you.
No.
How did that come about?
Well, I was introduced to Konstantin Bakalenikov, who was the music director at RKO, he was a very good musician, and he just decided that he wanted me to take on the hot seat, if you will.
There must have been some resentment among some of the male violinists.
If there was, I didn't feel it. Mm. I didn't feel it. I came with a kind of a reputation, and I don't know, I just, it worked.
Well, it certainly did. you did some of the best film scores ever
written. I did. As a matter of fact, last night I saw that For Whom the Bell Tolls was on the air, and I decided I haven't heard that in a long time. And I finally found the channel, and it was just before, there's an intermission in the picture when it's on television. And there I was, big as life, playing. So it was kind of fun.
Who were some of your favorite composers to work with and to play?
For the films? Mm-hmm. Well, Victor Young did the score for the bells. And Nicholas Rocha was a wonderful, he did a lot of spy stories and things of that kind. Ingrid Bergman was in a lot of the movies. And I just had a ball doing that. It was wonderful because they were writing such beautiful music. Ernst Toch did some movie scores, and some of the other musicians in town were just...
Andre Previn you worked with?
Andre, yes, yeah. I worked with him, yeah. I worked with The Apartment, mm-hmm. and who did the Around the World in 80 Days? Oh, that was Victor Young too.
Yeah, that's right.
So. With some of the remembrances I have.
Is there a solo or a couple of solos in films that you are particularly proud of that we can go back and rent on DVD?
You know, they're all so brief. Either somebody was dying or somebody was making love or kissing or something, and that's when the violin comes up.
No, but it was it's an incredible history of film music.
Yes, it is.
And film music has changed a lot, hasn't it, since then?
It has. I left when my class had grown at USC, and I was doing a lot of outside playing, a lot of concertizing, and I wasn't enjoying it anymore. It was a job, and I didn't like that. So I decided.
What had changed? Was the music itself had changed some? Or?
Sometimes there was less of it also, mm-hmm. and some, of course, was electronic.
Of course.
You see.
And what were the conditions like for a studio musician today? The salary is amazing. There are very, very strict union rules. You can't play more than, 1 minute over the hour.
True.
And stuff like that. Were you protected as well back then?
We were protected, probably not as well, but mm-hmm. there was always a strictness about, there was a 3 hour was the mm-hmm. least that one could do, mm-hmm. called a session. Mm-hmm. And there was a 10-minute break each hour. But you could work in those days until 3-4 o'clock in the morning and then be back at 9. I think that has changed, and certainly the price that musicians are getting today is much more with the times.
Yes, it's now. I'm sure it was then too. Very competitive to get those jobs.
Yes,
now
it was virtually
impossible.
It was. And for 7 years, actually, the musicians' union had us have contract mm-hmm. orchestras, so that if you worked in one orchestra in one studio, you did not go to another, so which was fine.
You were assured of a certain stability then in work.
True, because the other was all freelance work. In mm-hmm. other words, you waited for a call.
How did you come to teach at USC in the very early years of the USC School of Music?
Well, it was. Not very well known as a music school in those days. It had a small music department, but Gabor Reito, the cellist, was mm-hmm. invited to come here and be chairman of the music department. And we had met and we'd played chamber music together. And he asked if I was interested in teaching. I said, yes, I love teaching. And I had done it even as a student at Curtis, because Mr. Zimbalist always wanted his students and said, you will learn a great deal from teaching. You have to have some students. And of course, in Philadelphia, people would call Curtis and say, do you have a student? My child wants to study the violin. So I had started teaching really as a student in my teens.
Just let me stop you there for a second.
Yes.
Why did he feel it was important for his violinist to teach? I find that very interesting, because I'm sure you weren't the only concert caliber musician who was going to have a career. But to stop and teach at that young age is interesting.
Well, I think part of it was for us to become knowledgeable of how and why we did certain things on the instrument, and to really know that. And to be able to teach, one had to either verbalize or illustrate. It was a learning process. It is today. I mean, I still learn from my students what to do, what not to do sometimes. Because each one is an individual, and it has to be treated as so.
And did Mr. Raito know of your teaching background way back at Curtis?
Not that much, probably. Probably not that much, but he knew me as an instrumentalist, and I said, yes, I would love it. And the first two students were not even in the university. They were just going to graduate from high school. One of them, T.K. Wang, just retired from the Philharmonic, from the L.A. Philharmonic. And the other one was a young man, John Gorman. They were both high school students. They were my first two students.
And he also went on to become a professional violinist.
Yes, indeed, he did. Although he was a double major at school, he was in mathematics too. But he became associate concertmaster of the St. Louis Symphony. First, he went to the Boston Symphony and then to St. Louis.
It's amazing to look at how the music school has grown since those early years in your lifetime, and the 50 years you've been teaching. Was it always a place that took itself very, very seriously as really almost a conservatory atmosphere?
Yeah, I think perhaps the university doesn't like to call it a conservatory, but I feel that it has been like such during the years I've been there, because the concentration in the music department has been that important. And we've contributed greatly. We have series and series of concerts at school, whether they be by visiting artists, master classes by visiting artists, the graduation and junior recitals that our students give, at the chamber music concerts that they give. It's just rolling with music.
It certainly is. Talk about what it was like to have as a colleague Yasha Heifetz and also Gregor Piatigorsky back in those
they
earlier
were my
days.
Friends, and I love saying that, because that was the most important thing to me. But we played lots of chamber music together, had lots of parties and lots of fun together. And seriously, I mean, Mr. Heifetz was instrumental in getting my string quartet, which we had, the American Art Quartet, into doing some recording. And Piatigorsky, of course, was just a love of a person, and of course a great, great artist. And we just had wonderful times together, and they were my friends.
And you tutored Heifetz, I understand, a little bit about teaching.
Well, when he first came to USC to teach, he was, I think, a little worried about it, because he had not done any teaching. He said, you'll have to help me. Invited me to lunch at the house, you know, and we had a long talk about that. And actually, all he had to do was stand up and play, and that was a lesson for a student, as far as I was concerned.
Verbalizing didn't come as easily to him in a group of people as it came to Piatigorsky, is my impression, anyway. He was
no, you're absolutely right. Well, there was a different aura between the two men. One was very serious, Heifetz was very serious, and Grisha was just, you know, flamboyant and fun. And if he didn't have the words for it, he used whatever word he had.
You have told an amazing story of, I think it was just a chamber music party for fun on New Year's Eve once.
Yes.
When Heifetz surprised you with some funny business with the violin.
Indeed, indeed. We're playing along and all of a sudden he stops. And of course everybody stopped. We were a string quartet then. And he broke the violin over his knee. And I almost had a heart attack. I didn't know he was playing on a $5 violin because he sounded like Heifetz with that or with his own Stradivarius. But it was, afterward it was fun.
There is such a thing as a $5 violin, huh?
Well, there were in those days.
Okay. And on that occasion, I think you were all dressed up a little strangely, is that right? And
well, we had Lillian Stuber, who was one of the pianists at school, lovely, lovely, wonderful artist, and I decided we were going to have a little act together at one of the parties, and we went up to the opera department and found ourselves some old gowns and used them, and I found an old, like the first violin book that one gives a child, you know, and found some little pieces in it. And we were going to play these pieces, but of course I had to tune the violin to the piano, and she gave me the A, she struck the A, and I was all over the place, just all over. And finally she stood up, and in her pocket she had a one of those tuners for the piano, and she started to tune the piano to me. She gave up.
Oh, that would be pretty funny if that happened in concerts
funny.
All the time. Yeah. So Heifetz did have a sense of humor.
Yes, there was humor.
Were students intimidated by him, do you think?
I think some of them were, yes. Mm-hmm. I think so, yes. Because he was rather strict. He did mostly a master class ID, in other words, not really private lessons, but with the rest of his class surrounding.
I was very fascinated to read you say at one point that you really didn't practice all that much yourself as a young violinist, that it was more about the quality of the time you spent on the instrument than spending 8 hours in a practice room.
Right. I didn't know from practicing many hours. I think the most I ever practiced as a child was maybe less than 2 hours. But then I was guided. My father was there. Not necessarily when I practiced, but with the lessons which were given, you know, more than once a week. And the concentration, the mental attitude to practicing, mm-hmm. and I still say that is true today. If it's worked so that you really are concentrating for that time, you'll get more out of it mm-hmm. than getting physically tired of holding the violin.
So today, I mean, you've been telling your students the same thing, that 4, 8 hours, 6 hours in a practice room is not necessarily the way to become a great musician.
I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's necessary. I think if you practice 3, 4 hours and they're really concentrated, that the brain is more tired than the body, mm-hmm. that you get much more out of it.
Well, and you've also said that today, perhaps there's too much of an emphasis on technique and not as much an emphasis on personality of playing.
Mm-hmm. So yes, I've found that certain classes of students all sound alike. And that disturbs me because I just feel that it's such a personal instrument. There are others, mm-hmm. of course, the same. But for the violin, it is so personal that you must sing it in your own voice. And I think that's much more important. We take for granted that you have a certain prowess in dexterity. That's taken for, like mm-hmm. an athlete, you take that for granted. But what does he do with it?
Mm-hmm. You mentioned Heifetz. I can hear in my own mind, you know, a Heifetz Mendelssohn concerto, a Milstein Brahms concerto. You had an ability to just hear who was playing in those days.
That's true.
Not so much today.
No. No, unfortunately.
Do you find that your students tend to work too hard? Or I mean, how do they react when you tell them really an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours with great dedication is enough.
Well, most of my students, of course, are in the university. Mm-hmm. So they don't have that many hours to practice, unfortunately, because they're so busy with the homework of other classes, too. So I think that they're beginning to learn how to practice better. In other words, get more done, less time.
I think I remember a Piatigorsky masterclass that I saw on TV where he said pretty much the same thing, that if you put a chimpanzee in a studio for 8 hours a day, he could play a pretty good Dvorak concerto. But he didn't believe in that either, in spending your life in a practice room, because it's too confining.
True.
Yeah.
Because you see, usually it's as today, I go to bed sometimes thinking a piece. And I don't let go until practically that piece is over. But it's still in my head. In other words, I'm with the violin all the time, really.
You can practice mentally.
I can practice mentally, definitely.
That's pretty amazing.
And if a passage doesn't go, I slow up and go back and think it.
Really?
I do.
That's, I should have tried that on the piano. One thing that I've heard about your teaching is that you like your violin students to try viola.
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, first of all, it's strengthening. Because it's a firmer instrument that you have to work a little bit harder with the hands, mm-hmm. for violinists, that is. And also, I felt that it would give them a bigger range as far as working or making a career was concerned. And it's proven its worth, because I have violists today in the LA Philharmonic who were my violin students.
David Stockhammer, John Hayhurst.
John Hayhurst, Dale Hikawa, her name was, who's assistant first, viola, and so on. It's worked for them. One student who played her violin exam at the end of the semester, and she played very beautifully the violin, and then she had a viola exam. And I sat there with an open mouth, because this sound was so beautiful. It was a true viola sound. Mm-hmm. And I told her, I said, "You're a violist." And she burst into tears like I ruined her life. She became the first violist in St. Louis.
So she got over her initial shock.
She got over it, and she decided maybe I had something really truly to say there.
Isn't that something? Do you still find that some of the violinists treat the viola sort of with contempt or not seriously?
No. No. And more of them. I'm hoping to reinstall that it's at school, that they should take at least one semester of viola.
It does double their chances of getting work, doesn't it?
It certainly does. Yeah. My father was a violinist and a violist. I have his viola today, as a matter of fact, which I have learned through during the years to loan to students who were taking the course that we used to have at school.
Did you play viola too?
A little, not very much. Yeah. I was too busy on the violin.
You mentioned when we talked recently that perhaps the USC Music School is almost too big for its britches right now, that the days of when you first started were a much more intimate environment, and that you kind of miss
Well,
miss
I
that.
Probably was relating it to my Curtis days.
Yeah.
Because Curtis was small in comparison to any university grouping. And there was an intimacy about it that I don't have today. I don't know a lot of the students that I would like to know. And in the days at Curtis, I knew them from every department, from the wind department, from the piano department, and so on. It was just a cozier kind of atmosphere. Of course, I don't think university is a cozy. I shouldn't use the word cozy with that, because there's such big institutions these days.
You made that distinction a few minutes ago that that after all, your USC Thornton School of Music students have homework and other classes. What are the advantages of studying music at a large university where there's so much else going on aside from music?
Well, we do pride ourselves in that young musicians should have an education in other fields, whether it be economics. In not the word economics as such, but economically, I should say, mm-hmm. that they should learn, they should have something else in reserve, perhaps. Perhaps they won't get that one seat that's vacant in one of the big orchestras that they want. And they should have another career. Look how many doctors play the violin. They studied as children, but went to another field, but they still love their violin, and they play chamber music or play in the mm-hmm. doctor's orchestra or do something like that. And I just feel that the learning process of a university is wonderfully important for young people, because then they get a look-see at mm-hmm. a variety of things that they could do.
I was astonished to read that one of your most recent additions to the USC Thornton's faculty, Midori, recently finished a degree in psychology just to broaden her horizons.
Isn't that
one of
wonderful?
The great concert
yes,
violinists
yes.
of our time.
Yes, she's coming to us for more time now, which is very exciting.
But so it's important for a musician to see something of the world outside of
Absolutely,
music.
Absolutely, to be well-rounded, as we used to use that expression.
Are there too many music schools in this country, do you think, turning out kids who have perhaps unrealistic hopes of becoming the next Eudice Shapiro or the next Midori?
I think they all have expectations and mm-hmm. they all have dreams, which is terribly important. But no, I don't think there are too many. Mm-hmm. I think there could be lots of them. Of course, today things are quite divided because we have fiddlers and we have, you know, we have all sorts of things and violinists who are, they don't call themselves violinists, they call mm-hmm. themselves fiddlers. And they do all sorts of playing and all sorts of music, which is wonderful too.
One of your former students, Henry Choi, made a living doing something other than music.
Yes.
And has made an amazing gift to USC. Tell us about how that
he
came
has,
to happen.
He has, and his family, bless them, really. It's just absolutely wonderful that he thought that much of music and what he had done at the university, that they gave a beautiful endowment, a scholarship in my name mm-hmm. for a violin student, and it will go on, it will go on. And Henry, as a matter of fact, in a little concert that's happening this next week, is going to play in the Mendelssohn Octet, one of the violinists. Mm-hmm. I'm sure he's practicing his head off. But he did go into his father's business, and it's a very successful business, and that was what I started to say before. In other words, the learning of other things in a university setup mm-hmm. where there are choices. You still love your violin, you mm-hmm. still have a passion for it even, but you make a living doing something else. And that's okay too.
It's a beautiful illustration, I think, of how music can touch your life even if you don't achieve that dream of becoming Midori or Yasha Heifetz or Yehuda Shapiro, that you can still be so enriched by the experience that you do something like endow a gift to USC.
Isn't that wonderful? Yes.
What does music do for us, do you think? Why does it have such a hold on us?
Well, I don't know. It's a very, to me, it has always been a very emotional kind of thing. When there were things that were not going the way I wanted them, if I picked up the violin and started practicing, I relieved myself of all the stress around me. On the other hand, when you're happy, then the playing makes you happier, you know? And especially with doing a lot of teaching where you have young people surrounding you all the time, I call them my extended family because that's what they are. And it's loving. It's being one with a whole group of people, really.
And you've said that in music, one needs to say something, express something. It's really about communication, isn't it? It's
Indeed.
A way to touch people.
Indeed.
Without
Indeed.
Words.
Right, right. You don't need the words because your music is the communication.
The chamber music that you've done over the years, you described working with Heifetz and Piatigorsky at parties and so forth, having roomed with string players in college, chamber music just seems to light you folks up. It's just like there's nothing more fun or more, enriching. What is it about chamber music that makes it so great?
Well, you're part of a group. You're part of making this piece of music that was written by usually a great composer. Mm-hmm. And it's the togetherness. In other words, we're communicating with each other besides communicating with an audience that is listening to what we're doing, perhaps. Or we're doing it for ourselves. I remember one night, not with Heifetz, but with colleagues, we decided to play a Mendelssohn quartet. And we became so enthralled that we went through the whole book of Mendelssohn quartets. We didn't let it go until we finished all of them.
Oh, there are a lot
and
of them.
It was, you know, it's just so satisfying.
And your students, I presume, are also encouraged to play chamber music.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Very definitely. They have a lot of chamber music to do.
You learn from hearing each other as well?
Yes, yeah. How to play together, definitely, mm-hmm. definitely.
And I know Midori plays chamber music with her students.
As a matter of fact, one of my girls who's going to play again on this little mm-hmm. concert played with her in a mm-hmm. quartet, and she had a ball. She just loved it. She had such a good time, and Midori loved playing with her, wrote me a charming letter thanking me for her. It was really very sweet.
You performed many premieres and worked with some extraordinary composers of the century, including Ingolf Dahl, your longtime colleague at USC, Igor Stravinsky.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about the flavor of those Monday evening concerts that you participated in, that so many great musicians were part of.
Yes, well, we have wonderful musicians in this city who have, mm-hmm. of course, congregated from many, many cities, so we have really wonderful. Unfortunately, it took a war to bring composers here to live, mm-hmm. But then we were enriched by having Stravinsky live here and having Toch live here and Dr. Rubinstein lived here, and of course Heifetz came here to live, and Piatigorsky, and that's a richness that's unbelievable, really, in one city. And the composing and the sharing of their own music with the musicians here in town was very important. Monday evenings became from Evenings on the Roof, which mm-hmm. was a little group of musicians who got together to play in the sort of attic of the house. And
Peter Yates was the founder.
I beg your pardon?
Peter Yates.
Yeah. Yes. And his wife was a pianist, mm-hmm. and of course this part of it was probably to give her a platform, which was fine. And it graduated to the halls, to the chamber music halls of Los Angeles. It grew and grew, mm-hmm. became Monday evening concerts. And I see that the museum is going to inaugurate again another mm-hmm. series for this next year, which I'm very pleased at. And we played music that was new or scarcely played. Mm-hmm. And we sort of played for ourselves, and people came to hear us. We didn't do it for the money. It was practically nothing that we got, perhaps mm-hmm. $25 a concert or something like that. And we enjoyed ourselves, and that was the get-together of musicians in a larger scale than just having chamber music in somebody's home.
it became a historic series.
Indeed.
Where many important works were premiered.
Oh my, premiered, absolutely, absolutely.
Talk a little bit about what it was like playing with Ingolf Dahl, a longtime colleague at USC.
He was wonderful. He would sit like this, you know, and think about what he was going to do next, and then he would burst into laughter, and we would enjoy what it was. But he was a wonderful colleague, just a marvelous colleague. And we played together a great deal, and he conducted for me at Ojai Festival and at school also. And he was looking up always things that weren't played very often, which was my delight too.
He was very knowledgeable about all of music, wasn't he?
Yes, very. Yeah. And a beautiful pianist, wonderful pianist. And conductor, absolutely.
And one of his students was Michael Tilson Thomas, whose name sounds familiar.
Right.
The longtime music director of San Francisco Symphony, mm-hmm. who was also involved in some of those concerts as a pianist.
Oh, yes.
And what was it like working with Stravinsky?
Well, that was very exciting for me because mm-hmm. I wasn't sure of how this was going to be. Mm-hmm. I had been asked to play his concerto, and he was going to be the conductor. And it was a little nerve-wracking mm-hmm. at first, but I learned the piece, and I loved the piece. And we got together at his home, and he sat at the piano. We did very well together, evidently. But the funny thing is that I remember him best, and this is mm-hmm. kind of kooky. He offered me a drink of scotch after one of the rehearsals. And I never drank scotch. But I took it, and I found that I liked it. And so that was my remembrance of Mr. Stravinsky. He would, I wonder if he would frown or he would laugh if I told him that story.
He introduced you to scotch.
Yes.
The pictures, photographs of him that come down, there's sometimes a puckish smile, but usually very serious. And certainly his writings on music are dead serious. Mm. Was he that serious to work with in a group when he was conducting? Was it all business, or did he have a sense of humor?
He was buried in the music, definitely. But don't forget, I met him when he was already an old man. Mm-hmm. And there were serious slowing down, mm-hmm. I think, by that time. Although when we did the concerto, he was just as sprightly mm-hmm. and just as knowledgeable as a young person would be. But afterward, when we did a recording of Aegon, mm-hmm. and he came to the recordings I did mm-hmm. of his Divertimento and the Pulcinella Suite and a lot of pieces that he gave me the music to. Mm-hmm. In other words, the printed music he gave to me, which are quite out of print. He was very serious about mm-hmm. music and very serious about having performances.
Do you think he knew of his own stature in the musical world?
Oh, I think so. Mm-hmm. I think so. Yeah, there was a lot of ego there, definitely.
He knew that he was Stravinsky.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. And he. Yeah. It was Stravinsky, and that name will never be forgotten.
And what about the interesting lore about Schoenberg and Stravinsky living in the same town at the same time, but not really getting together? Was there
no
bad blood there?
They were like two different schools. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there was a bit of antagonism. Although I remember Stravinsky being at a concert of Schoenberg works. That I do remember, especially in Ojai. I think I have a little photograph of him with the score in hand.
Interesting. So he was looking at the score,
yes,
listening
yes,
to the music.
Yes.
Took him somewhat seriously. Mm. Well, that must have been such a rich time to be in Los Angeles. I can hardly imagine it. Yeah.
I was very fortunate to be here at that time.
There's a big thrust now at the USC Thornton School to spread the word about classical music, not just within the music school, but within the university as a whole, and then outside the university into the community. This is something that Dean Curiera is passionate about, that mm-hmm. Midori is passionate about, and At a time when music education has all but disappeared from public schools, is that an important mission for the university to try and have people not just in the music department fall in love with music and have music part of their lives?
I think it's terribly important. I think it's wonderful, and I'm so pleased that our dean has taken this on his shoulders, because I just have this feeling, as I said before, of communication and of the love of humanity and of the feeling of togetherness, and let's not make war, let's make love. And I think that the Thornton School has become very well known, not only in Los Angeles, but all through the world, actually, because we do get people from every country you can imagine.
There's something eminently healing about music and art, isn't there? If
right.
only people will let it.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Let it come in.
Before we wrap up, I have to ask you one non-musical question. How do you stay so slim and gorgeous and young at your age, which we won't mention, but
you can mention
an impressive age.
I don't mind it at all. Well, I think that I feel young, and I think the feeling comes from being associated with the young people that I'm with all the time. And I think that's the remarkable thing about teaching, is that you feel like one of them. In other words, they're all my family, you know, and I have something to give them, and they have something to give to me. And I think that's kept me kind of excited about living.
So teaching as a beauty secret.
If you call it that.
Okay, we'll keep that in mind. And you're passing on the gene, I understand, to a grandson who's about to start college
yes,
in Los
he's
Angeles.
He's passionate about the guitar,
yeah.
And he's coming out to California. As a matter of fact, he's coming this afternoon. He will be staying here, and that means that I'll have him a little closer to me because his home is Colorado.
Well, that's a blessing.
But he loves music. He loves the guitar, and he's gifted and creative with the instrument. So I don't know whether he'll go on to be a musician or maybe he was just with a group from his school, the Rocky Mountain School. He was with them in Trinidad, and he was. Labeling turtles and tortoises and all that sort of thing, and he's very excited about that too. So I don't know which way his life will go, but again, coming back to having something else in your life, it may be that he'll play music for fun. I don't know.
Well, being exposed to you and closer to you,
true,
music may just win out.
It could be. I don't know.
Well, thank you for an enthralling interview.
Thank you.
Great to talk to you. And congratulations on 50 years of teaching at the Thornton School.
Thank you. I've enjoyed it every minute.